Good evening, and welcome to tonight's Driver's Ed class. I see we've got a few people already tuned in. So, as we normally do, we'll do the sign-in on the YouTube channel, and then you'll go to your phone and you'll sign in there. Now, I'm going to mention this a few times. People have to sign in on their phone. You have to sign out. It's your phone that's giving me a record that I can keep and scroll through to see whether you're here or not. So hopefully everybody had a good day. Today was probably the first day in a long time that I've actually gone outside and did some things, ran some errands, did a little bit of work in the garden. Warmer weather is here. Supposed to have a good weekend. So hopefully people will have a chance to get out, maybe not socialize, but to at least get out and take advantage of the warmer weather. So good evening, everybody. I'm seeing more names coming up on the YouTube comments, which is good. Looks like we almost have a full class. Like I said, it's very important that you're here for the whole thing, because at the beginning, we do like a review of what we went over from last night, and then at the very end, we're going to talk about your homework and what your assignment is, and kind of wrap things up. So try to stay from the beginning to the very, very, very end. So first thing that I want to do, let me get out of the music here. The first thing I want to kind of go over is the worksheets that you had to do, the two worksheets. Now, some of you weren't able to find every single item, and that's fine. But if you are curious what each thing meant, I do have the answer key that I'm going to throw up on the board right now. So the first bank. So let's take a look at this. I know that some of the images were very difficult to see, and you couldn't really read what was written. So the first item, A, is on a pickup truck, young children should not be sitting in the passenger seat. If they're going to be sitting in the passenger seat, there is going to be an airbag on and off switch that you have to dial to the off. You do not want a front airbag going off on a child. I believe it's around 4 years of age or younger. Okay, they don't want them with the airbag. B is airbag readiness. So that comes on the minute you start your car. We saw that on the video last night. Remember, it's red. It's trying to get your attention. Now, remember, we talked about red is it needs your attention. Yellow just means that's activated, it's on. It's a cautionary light. ABS is your anti-lock braking system. We'll talk more about that when we have a topic of braking systems, when we talk about driving emergencies. Theft, when you lock your car, this should be activated, so it'll probably be blinking inside your vehicle when you leave. Auxiliary power point is what we plug our phone into. F is for your battery. So if this battery light comes on, I want you to put down in your notes that you're losing battery power, you should find a place to pull over. Okay? When the battery charging system is not working, it'd be just like the warning on your phone when you see that red on that battery. Okay? It's the same type of thing, because you're going to have to replace your battery or replace your alternator. And we'll talk more about what an alternator is used for. Brake system warning light is exclamation. H, the exclamation point here just means like maintenance required. Okay. Doesn't really mean injury, like, you know, you're going to hurt yourself. It means like the car could be hurt or damaged. I is your climate control. J is for your door locks on and unlocking and locking. K is your oil light. Just like the battery light, this is something that you want to tend to quite quickly. You do not want to be driving for a period of time with your oil light on because you will definitely ruin your engine. Same thing with the temperature gauge. It looks like a thermometer. Some cars have an H and a C. So C stands for cold. H is for hot. M is fasten your seatbelts. N is your fog lights. The first time I took this quiz when someone gave it to me, we were at a conference and I had no clue what N was. So fog lights. And fog lights are different than your parking lights. Okay, it's not the same thing. They're pinched in a little bit tighter on your grill down at the bottom. They're usually another white light or maybe a yellow, but they're closer in at the very, very bottom. Oh, there's an echo? Thanks. Let's see if I can get... Let's see if this works at all. Thanks for telling me, though. Maybe I'm too close. Four-wheel drive is O, P is your fuel gauge, Q is fuses, R is your hazard lights, S is your windshield wiper, and then the next group of symbols, T is your day running lights, and this is something that I'm going to require you to use at all times when you drive in the driver's ed vehicle. We always have our day running lights on. U is your hood release, V is horn, W is your ignition switch, telling you the different activation modes of whether you're using just your electrical system or you're turning the car over to turn on. X is your dimmer switch, Y is a lighter, although I don't think they make lighters now for cars. Z, headlight switch, and this is going to be on the windshield wiper knob. A is your overdrive defeat. Double B is your parking lights. Double C is your side view mirror control. That is something we went over last night. Oh, good. It's fixed now. Thanks. DD is your power windows. EE, power window defrost. Speed control. This is something that we don't necessarily use. Okay, if you want to use the cruise control when you're in the driver's ed car, you've got to remind me. It's not something that I've planned into our routes and our scheduled driving time. So just remind me of that. Tilt wheel, most people don't take advantage of the tilt wheel. So you should be very comfortable in your position. HH, trunk release. Double I's, your turn signals. Double J is your defroster, double K is your washer, double L is your wipers, and double M is ETS. I do want you to write down ETS right now in your notes. Electronic traction system. All cars built now will have an electronic traction control. And what this does, this is what I want you to write down. When one tire slips on the roadway, let's say it could be dirt, it could be snow, the other three wheels that have contact with the road will have a lower torque and better pulling power to get you out of that loss of traction with that one wheel. So it senses when the wheels aren't spinning at the same time or level, and it gives more power to the ones that are still on contact with the road. That's the easiest way to explain it. So I hope that was helpful to go over. You should be very familiar with your controls. Yesterday's lesson was basically getting ready to drive, what to do, to check around the vehicle, have your gauges, have everything adjusted before you're out on the road. Today we're going to focus on our safety equipment. And it is so important to understand that in different states, there are going to be different laws coming around seatbelts. So it's mainly seatbelts that we're talking about tonight, although we are going to talk about airbags and helmets. But your seatbelt is your first course of action for safety, for keeping you upright in your good driving posture that you want to be in, and to prevent you from hitting the dashboard or the steering wheel. So that's what we're going to focus on tonight. So what's the real story about these three safety devices? And why is there such a fuss about putting a seatbelt on? I'm a licensed driver. I've been deemed as being safe and skilled. I should have that option of whether I use my seatbelt or not. So what I want you to write down in your notes, New Hampshire is the only state in the country that does not require mandatory seatbelt for those that are older than 18. Once you get to be the age of 18, you now can make the decision whether you're going to wear your seatbelt or not. And we'll talk a little bit more about that a little bit later tonight. Now, how has safety changed? We had a lesson, I think, two nights ago when we talked about the HTS and the future of cars and how we're building them and how they're going to be self-driving. Well, we're constantly trying to make our cars safer. And this was taken from a vehicle back in the 1960s. So I don't know how old your parents are, but probably there's a good chance they weren't quite in this child restraint, but they're probably not that far removed, especially if you've got older uncles or aunts. They may have been in this position. So that doesn't look too safe. We would never put a child in that position now. So who is least likely to wear a seatbelt? What we have found that most young people, and there are many reasons why people come up with why they don't wear a seatbelt. I'm in a hurry. I'm a good driver. I don't want it to wrinkle my clothes. I don't think they're that effective. So there are a number of reasons why people probably don't wear a seatbelt. But we have found more young people are less likely than older age groups. And we find men more less likely to wear seatbelts than women. And basically people that are in a city, because of probably the slower speeds, they're less likely to wear seatbelts than someone that lives in a rural area. So this is what I want you to write down. Since I already told you that New Hampshire is the only state, that once you leave the state of New Hampshire, you are still required to follow the laws of other states. So your question would be, well, Mr. Toll, how am I supposed to know that? Well, you're learning it right now. And when you move your vehicle from one state to another state, let me get out of this for a minute and go into so you can see me. When you go from one state to another state, there are going to be billboards and signs, okay, that are going to tell you the importance of certain state laws that they want you to do. I'm going to give you three. Seatbelts. There's going to be a sign telling you about wearing your seatbelt in that particular state. Their law on texting or distracted driving. The third thing that they're going to post and tell you probably about is drinking and driving. They're going to say, we enforce our drunk driving laws, and they're going to probably put some penalties down. And you're going to probably drive right by it because you're probably thinking it doesn't really, you know, pertain to me. And hopefully it doesn't. But at some point, when you get of drinking age and you're out visiting friends and you're going to another state, you got to know that now it does. Now, this is a breakdown of usage. Now, even though we don't have a mandatory seatbelt law in New Hampshire, the statistics show, and you can tell by the graph right here, that we have the lowest percentage of people using their seatbelts. So the darker color blue is the highest percentage of people wearing seatbelts. So we got Texas, California, Oregon, Washington, Wisconsin, Minnesota, Illinois, or Indiana. They're going to have probably some of the harshest seatbelt laws. So if you're going to school in these areas for college, then just be aware of that. And The other thing that I want you to be familiar with when it comes to seatbelt laws, write down primary traffic laws and secondary traffic laws. You've probably never heard of this before, but I want you to have a basic understanding of this. So most traffic offenses are primary violations, means that if they see you doing something like speeding, failing to stop at a red light or a stop sign, they're going to pull you over and give you a ticket. Okay, that's all they have to do, is they have to see you do that. Now, a secondary traffic law means that you have to be breaking a primary law and you have to be doing this secondary traffic law. So let's say that you were speeding and didn't have your seatbelt on. So you get a speeding ticket as the primary, and now they can give you the ticket for your seatbelt. But if you didn't have your seatbelt on and you are going the speed limit, they can't pull you over because you don't have your seatbelt on. Does that make sense? Okay, so I'm going to say that one more time. A secondary offense, they have to pull you over and give you a ticket for something else before that secondary offense comes into play. And distracted driving in some states can be a secondary offense, depending on what you're doing. It may not be a primary. But we're going to have another lesson class on cell phone use and distractions as drivers. But that's near the last week of class. So what is the impact of seatbelt use? We have found that seatbelt reduces serious crash-related injuries by about half. And that's a pretty good percentage. I think we know that we want to save lives. And even though we know our car is equipped with airbags, airbags are only going to be effective if we know that we've got our seatbelt on. And we talked about that yesterday, about the dead pedal. By pushing down on that left foot, your body's not going to move from side to side, and it's going to keep you in your position. So what can states do? What can we do to make people want to use their seatbelts? So some of the strategies of moving their secondary offenses to primary offenses. We want to make sure that it applies to everybody, because in some states they only give it to the people that are in the front seat that aren't belted, and they don't care about the people in the back. And we're going to see a video why it's just as important to have it on in the back as it is in the front. They just got to stress it with the local police and the state troopers to make sure that if there is a law in the state, you got to give out the ticket. That's your job, is enforcement. And a lot of police officers that I have friends, they really hate giving out certain types of tickets. But if they know that people are breaking the law, that is just something that they're required to do. So what can health professionals do? Now, we're talking about nurse practitioners, doctors, nurses. They've got to stress. And sometimes when you're in a doctor's office, they may ask you, do you wear your seatbelt? They're trying to push that safety. Just like right now, we're trying to push everybody should have a mask on when you're out in public. Same thing, parents. Parents are a great advocate, and we get modeling from our parents. So parents have to take the necessary steps to train their kids to have their seatbelt on, to make sure when you're, you know, all children up to the age of 12 are in those different grades of child restraints. You're starting from an infant seat, going up to a booster seat, and then you got your lap belt and harness. So it's very important to just don't skip those, to make sure that everybody's belted the way that they're supposed to. And basically, you've got to take the desire of making it an important thing to incorporate in your drive. Don't say that you're in a hurry, that you're not going that far. All the typical excuses that we mentioned, you just can't buy into that. You've got to say, I'm in a car, this is important, I'm going to be in my seatbelt. So how does New Hampshire actually stack up? Like I said, we've got the lowest percentage of seatbelt usage. Between the year 2003 and 2012, there have been about 919 motor vehicle occupants killed and vehicles in New Hampshire.
And as you can see, the highest age group is on a national level is the 21 to 34 bar. Look how high that is. And then it just kind of goes down and then it kind of creeps back up again. And we can see down at the bottom here with the two male and females that males are more likely not to be in belts and to be killed in a car crash than a female. Now, New Hampshire has just put into the state legislature a possibility of enacting a new law. And I found this in February. You can see at the second sentence here, from a 10-9 vote from the House of Transportation Committee, they're going to review this bill on the next month. And it's trying to push to make seatbelts for adults only in the front seat, not in the back seat. So I would like to see everybody in the car belted. But right now, they're only trying to push for the people in the front. And if you take a look at New Hampshire's license plate, Live Free or Die, we really just hang on to that motto for everything when it comes towards safety. No one wants to be told what to do. So whether it be seatbelts or using your helmet when you're on a motorcycle, it's really hard to get past a law to make it mandatory for everybody to have this safety measure enacted. So hopefully, you know, I don't think they're going to get to it right now because we've got so many issues in the state trying to reopen, trying to get you guys where you can drive with me. They're going to probably table this and not deal with it for a while. Let me show you what this was, a PSA, and this is going to be part of your homework. So I want you to take a look at this and we'll talk about what your homework's going to be and just a little bit. Let's see if I can find. Here it is.
Please consider your safety in your travels. Do you need to be on the roadways? How are you driving your vehicle? What are you doing to keep yourself as safe as you can for what can be taking place around you? Be safe, everyone.
Like they said in the video, there is so much that you can control with a seatbelt. I mean, that's totally within your control, but you can't control the weather. You can't control the shape that the road is in. So we have to take that into consideration when we're out on the road. I normally don't show a lot of gruesome videos, but this one, although there's no, you can't see the image, but I'm going to show you a video of someone being thrown from a vehicle. So watch real carefully because it comes really, really quick. So someone crossed over the center line, over the median, and hit another vehicle. A couple cars spun out, and I don't know if you could see it, but that was actually a body flying up through the air. One thing about being in a seatbelt, it is going to keep you in the vehicle. You never, ever want to find yourself leaving the vehicle. What I want you to write down, the movement of a belted occupant. What I want you to understand that even though you've got your seatbelt on, your body is still going to move forward. So what I want you to write down is your head is going to move 1.9 feet around 30 miles per hour. So we're talking about in town driving. Your chest is going to go 1.3 feet at 30 miles per hour. Your pelvis is going to go at 1.2 feet. So your pelvis isn't moving that much at all. So there will be some movement of your body. Now, another thing you've got to take into consideration, if you've got a heavy winter coat or sweater, if you do not pull on the seatbelt and make it, you know, kind of tight, then there's going to be a little bit more movement. And this was based on a 150-180 pound a person. Didn't have to be male, but that weight. So the more a person weighs, probably the further they're going to go. The less that they weigh, they're probably not going to move quite that distance. This is what a vehicle would look like, and this is why it's so important to make sure that you have a car that has a good crash rating. So even though we're talking about seatbelts, we should also be talking about how safe is the car that you're driving. So make sure that you're getting a 4 or 5 star crash rated vehicle, and we're going to see a little bit more on a video on that a little bit later today. But this is from, I believe, 2004 Chevy, I believe. And your left leg was going to be mangled if you were driving this vehicle. And notice the speed was pretty slow. It was below probably in-town speed. So 27 miles per hour is not very fast. This is what an airbag would look like. These are the devices of how an airbag is going to be deployed. There is a sensor to the front of the vehicle. Remember, write this down in your notes. An airbag is only good for front or side crashes. Getting hit from behind, you do not have the benefit of an airbag coming out for you. So sides, front, there are sensors that's going to know and they're going to come out. But more than anything, they're right near your headlights. So let's take a look at airbags and we'll try to explain them the best we can.
Not only does it ruin your day, but it can leave you with serious injuries or much worse. A proliferation of people refusing to wear seatbelts in the United States back in the 70s led to car makers designing better safety systems to stop natural selection from wiping out a population. And they were called airbags.
Today, airbags are one of the most common safety features you'll find in a new car. But how exactly do they work?
In simple terms, airbags are tightly packed nylon bags designed to inflate within milliseconds of an impact occurring, stopping your head and body from hitting points around the vehicle like the steering wheel, windows, or other hard points, which can cause serious damage.
Sensors around the vehicle are able to detect an impact force, like another vehicle hitting yours, sending an electronic message to deploy whichever airbags are needed to protect occupants. The car is able to work out whether the impact is significant enough, as the force of the airbag deploying may do more harm than good in a low-speed accident. While early airbags were designed purely to protect the driver, most new cars have an array of airbags spread around the cabin to protect every occupant.
The Santa Fe we have here has 6 airbags, one in the steering wheel, one in the passenger side dash, one in either of the front seats, and curtain airbags that cover all 3 rows.
Again, because airbags deploy with significant force, you can do yourself serious damage if your arms get in the way or if you're simply sitting too close.
Once upon a time, the correct way to hold the steering wheel was at a 10 and 2 position. But driving instructors now say the best position is a 9 and 3, so the airbags have enough room to deploy without causing serious damage by having your arms in the way.
But there's more to occupant safety than just airbags. Cyclist and pedestrian detection systems are another important safety feature that you'll hear more about in the future. In the Santa Fe, it's called Side Exit Assist. If an occupant attempts to open the door while vehicles, cyclists, or in our case, someone on a skateboard is close by, the system will sound an alarm and in some cases prevent the door from being unlocked. The system also reminds the driver to check surroundings are safe before unlocking passenger doors. If you do open the door while a hazard is detected, you'll get this warning. Finally, we have child presence detection systems. So far, Hyundai is the first car maker to introduce the tech, reminding drivers to check the rear seats before exiting the vehicle. It's called Rear Occupant Alert. The system uses sensors in the ceiling to detect movement after the vehicle has been locked. It stays active for 24 hours and will sound the car's alarm if it thinks you've left someone behind. If you've installed Hyundai's AutoLink app on your smartphone, you'll also receive a text if you haven't tended to the car alarm. Just as airbags can save you in the case of an accident, car makers are constantly developing tech like Side Exit Assist and Rear Occupant Alert to prevent accidents happening in the first place.
Okay, I thought that was kind of an interesting video. For one, being from Australia, the accent was kind of cool. Also that the steering wheel was over on the right-hand side. But the two features that they mentioned, so I'm noticing that people are not watching today's class. So what I want you to write down and text to me right now, they talked about something that's going to aid you when a bicycle comes next to you. What was that called in the video? So text that to me right now. So I want to see my phone exploding in the next minute or two. And I also thought it was kind of cool that if you had left somebody in the vehicle, that it's going to alert you that maybe a young baby toddler was left in the car. So that was something new that I hadn't seen before. And I don't believe that we have that over here, but it will probably just be a matter of time before we do. The next two terms that I want you to write down and be familiar with is the term passive and active. Okay, passive means automatic. So what would be a automatic device? The one that comes to mind is what we just saw in the video, airbags. There is nothing that you have to do but buy a car that is equipped with all those special features. That is a passive device. Now, an active device would be a lap belt, shoulder harness, child restraints, three-point harness. They don't use that much anymore. This is where you have separate clips for the lap belt and the shoulder harness, or the shoulder harness comes around from the door frame. So, some people are watching. You get extra credit for answering the questions right and to be sticking along. So if I find out who's not paying attention during class or who's not tuning in each night, there's going to be hell to pay. Airbags, okay? No passenger under 12 in the front seat, so it's a little bit higher than what I told you earlier for a truck. I thought it was about the same as a booster seat, so it's 12 years of age in New Hampshire. Airbags will protect forehead and chest injuries. This is what I want you to write down for the midterm, so I'm going to come out of here for a second. The distance, I'm going to use my microphone. The distance from your chest to the steering column has to be at least 10 inches to a foot. So write that down in your notes, because you've got to be able to allow that airbag room to come out. So when you're too close, we saw that on the video last night, it's going to do too much damage to you. So I will test you on having that 10 inches to 12 inches distance. Okay, that's what I want you to remember from that video. If you're too short, you may have to raise your seat up. Use a wedge-type cushion to have you sit up in your seat. And understand that there's going to be airbags on the side. And that's to help you with SUVs and trucks where you have a higher center of gravity and there's a chance in a crash that the vehicle may roll over. And anyways, on a T-bone, you want that protection. A T-bone crash means you're getting hit from the side.
Now, what is the reason why you don't want to put your feet on the dash? Okay. How many of you put your feet on the dash when you're a passenger? It may be comfortable, but watch what happened to this particular girl. Can you imagine? This is the way her forehead is going to be for the rest of her life. This is from putting her foot on the dashboard when she was a passenger, when someone was driving. The other thing we don't know either is that what kind of head trauma. Definitely had a concussion, but we don't know if there was any brain damage. We'll see a video tonight about helmet use where it's pretty bad. These are the safety points for putting your seatbelt on. We kind of went through that in the video last night, so I'm not going to do that. But I do want to mention down at the bottom where it says head restraints, adjusted so it meets ear level. So I'm going to get out of this again. So the bottom of the headrest should be right about here. And I think I'm going to show you a PowerPoint slide that talks about ramping. So write down the word ramping, and I'm going to turn to the side. And I want to show you that in a crash, your body's going forward in the seatbelt, and then it's going backwards. Remember we talked about pitch? So in a crash, you stop, and then you go back. Now, when your head goes back, see, it goes over the top. This is all these muscles get torn and pulled away from the bone in a crash. That's called ramping. Okay, so write down ramping. Ramping is when your head goes over the top of the seat or the headrest. So people that are extremely tall, they've got to make sure that it meets the bottom of their chin, the back of their ear. That's what they were talking about there. Okay, let's talk about children a little bit. Okay, they got to be at least 40 inches tall to have the shoulder harness. Now, I'm sure most of you, when you were little, you had the harness, you didn't like it, so you took it and you put it over the back of you. You don't want to do that. You want to make sure that you use that adjustment on the door frame that will bring it down. And if you're less than 6 years old, that's what I was thinking about with the airbag. Or 55 inches in height, you're going to be in a specially child design passenger seat. And we all know the law. If you're under 18, you've got to be buckled. And that's the only law that we have here in New Hampshire. So let's take a look at making sure that kids are safe.
More than 1,000 children 12 and under die in car crashes every year, and more than 100,000 are injured. But parents can reduce the risk to their kids if they put them in an appropriate car safety seat that's correctly installed in their vehicle. When a vehicle is moving at 30 miles per hour, so is everything inside it. If the vehicle crashes, unrestrained objects keep moving at their original speed until they strike the vehicle interior. This is why infant and child car seats are so important. They hold child passengers in place as the vehicle's front end does its job of crumpling and absorbing energy. This test demonstrates something parents don't even want to think about: an unprotected infant smashing into the instrument panel. Some parents think it's okay to ride with a child on their lap, but it's not. Crashes happen so fast and are so violent that you can't protect a child this way. Frontal airbags can be especially dangerous. In a crash, an airbag can hit a child or car seat with tremendous force. Even older children shouldn't sit in the front seat. The temptation to play with the radio can put them in harm's way. Children are always safer in the back seat. The basic types of car seats are rear-facing infant seats, forward-facing child seats, convertible seats that can be used either rear or forward-facing, and booster seats for children who've outgrown their forward-facing seat but aren't big enough for adult seat belts. Consider your child's age and size when picking out a car seat and whether it's compatible with your vehicle's seat and seat belts. Not all car seats will fit well into your vehicle. Proper installation has always been a struggle, but it is getting easier. Since September 2002, passenger vehicles are required to have special anchors, and most car seats have to be made with attachments that fit into them. This system is called latch. Lower attachments mate with anchors in the seat. Anchor points are usually marked. For forward-facing seats, top tethers get attached to anchors on the rear shelf or on vehicle seat backs. Car seats and vehicles without latch are still safe if you use the vehicle's belt system correctly. In order to do this in some vehicles, you may need to use a locking clip. Keep in mind, a car seat that fits easily into one vehicle may not fit very well, if at all, into another. Before you buy a car seat, try it in your vehicle to be sure it's compatible and can be tightly secured. Also, be sure to read the seat and vehicle owner's manuals to make installation go more smoothly. In some communities, you can check the installation at county checking stations, police or fire stations, car dealerships, or hospitals. If you're in a severe crash, inspect your child's car seat. If there's visible damage, you'll need to replace it. Remember, your child's safety is up to you. Always be sure he or she is properly buckled in without fail, every ride.
Okay, they talked about three different safety restraints for young children. But when you're talking about a newborn, probably up to the age of three, you basically want them in the number two position. If you only have one child, always put them in the middle. Because anytime that there's going to be a crash, a T-bone on the side of the vehicle coming from this side on the left side of the vehicle or over here on the right side of the vehicle, position number one or position number three is going to get the brunt of that T-bone. So I always tell my students that if you have, you know, brothers and sisters, parents always put their favorite child in position number two. They put their next favorite child here and the troubled child, okay, right here. No, but basically go in a position that you're going to be able, and if you're driving, you have better access to dealing with an infant in position number two or one. You're not going to be able to deal with someone that's directly behind you. You just can't reach back and help them out at all. Now, once they get to be around three, they should be able to understand and do some things on their own. But a very young child would not be able to do that, like a pacifier or choking or something like that. Don't have to worry about who doesn't need to be belted. Of course, if you're in a school bus, and a lot of people have asked that question, why? And I was always told that if there was a crash, the bus driver wouldn't be able to get everybody out. And of course, there aren't seat belts on motorcycles or older vehicles, you know, from the 40s. They didn't have them. And the last one, most people didn't realize that if a child has some type of individual educational plan with a note indicating that it's unsafe, then they're probably strapped in their wheelchair to a device in the van. Let's talk about motorcycle. It was a real nice day. Saw a few motorcycles out on the road. I would say the majority of the people that I saw today did not have helmets on. So let's talk about the helmet law. What is the helmet law? The only thing we have, there is no mandatory, just like seatbelts. Helmets is not mandatory for those older than 18. Under 18, or if you are a passenger under 18, you have to have a helmet. So make sure you write that down. The last thing, even those that choose not to wear a helmet, they still have to have eye protection. So let's take a look at helmets. I'm going to go through this here.
A properly fitting helmet is your best choice to protect from serious or even fatal head injury. In fact, a head injury is the most common cause of death for motorcyclists. Helmets are most effective at neutralizing glancing blows rather than dead stop impacts. Thankfully, glancing blows are the norm in crashes.
But if you ran full tilt at a telephone pole, you would exceed the engineering limitations of even the very best helmet.
What we do know from the best studies that in the event of a crash, a motorcycle helmet will reduce your risk of death by 42% and reduce the risk of head injury by 69%.
Here's a breakdown of the areas on a helmet most often damaged in a crash. Studies have shown 3/4 of impact damage happens on the front of helmets. The front, visor and chin bar areas get the most damage, which means over 1/3 of all head injuries, primarily to the face, would not be covered by an open face compared to a full face helmet. This rises to almost 40% for a half shell. Standards and impact testing of all helmet types is incredibly important. We visited Crash Lab in Sydney to better understand the tests they do. The outer shell is the first line of protection. It works with the strap to keep the helmet on your head. It will flex in a crash and may crack. The inner impact absorption layer is the critical stage of defence. It's made up of EPS, better known as expanded polystyrene. The density and thickness of the EPS makes a huge difference to how well it cushions your brain. Newer helmets have low density EPS against your head and harder EPS against the shell, so a relatively minor impact doesn't give you a concussion. The strap is critical for keeping the helmet on your head in a crash. Helmets come off in around 11% of all crashes, which is frightening. This can also happen if the helmet is too big, even when the strap is done up. Proper fit is essential for effective protection.
I mean, it really is just conveying that a motorcycle helmet's going to stop your brain from bouncing around inside your skull when you have a crash.
Head injuries are horrible things, from mild concussions to death. All public health studies tell us that wearing a helmet improves your survival odds significantly.
Systematic reviews, like the study that we did, can't tell you which particular helmets are the best helmets to wear. But if you're wearing a helmet that fits you correctly and is appropriately standard certified, that's going to give you the best protection in the event of a crash.
So do yourself a favour and wear one. You know it makes sense.
So you can see that most of the damage is being done to the front part of the face. So the eye protection is extremely important, but more than that, having a helmet on. And as I mentioned with the girl that had her feet on the instrument panel, and I questioned whether we saw the deformity of her skull, but whether there was any type of brain damage. Now, the person that we're going to see next in the video does not have any brain damage, and he is so fortunate, and he mentions that, but he didn't end up too well with his motorcycle crash. So let's see his story.
Hey YouTube, it's Brian. Today's video I feel is very long overdue. Kind of wanted to talk about my motorcycle accident and more importantly the helmet that I was wearing in the accident. In 2009 I was pulling out of my work parking lot. I was pulling onto a fairly busy road and there was a bunch of parallel parked cars on the side of the road. So when I pulled out I turned right and I didn't see an oncoming car that was actually speeding. And right after I pulled out, the road started to curve. So what happened was I pulled out, saw this car coming, floored the bike trying to get out of the way, and got a little too close to the curve, the actual curb of the road. And there were a bunch of trees on the side of the road, and I happened to tip the bike over against the curb and slammed headfirst into a tree. I was doing about 35 miles an hour. Not anything crazy fast, but this is what happened to my helmet after the accident. As you can see, I caved in the entire top of the helmet. As a result, this broke my spinal cord, and from the chest level down, I'm now paralyzed. So I know you're probably thinking, you know, why would I want to listen to a guy who's paralyzed talk about helmet safety? Well, there's quite a few reasons. First being that I have zero brain injury. That was the biggest thing. My injury is completely physical, which has allowed me to do a lot of things. Obviously, I can still work. I co-manage a group of over 30 people. I can actually still take care of myself. I can take care of my bathroom routine. I can get myself dressed. I am fully independent. I'm married. I have a beautiful wife. I have a great job. I have, you know, a sports car. I like to autocross my car, which is a form of racing, and I do that quite a bit. I still work on cars. That's something I've always really loved to do. So there's a lot of things in my life that I don't think I would have been able to do had I had a brain injury. As you can see, I wouldn't have even had that chance had I slammed headfirst into a tree. I would have been completely dead. There was no way that I would be sitting here talking to you today. I actually went through rehab with a guy who had a similar accident. He was going through an intersection on his bike. A car was coming through, ran a red light. He slammed into that car, flipped off his bike, and he didn't have a helmet on, and he hit his head real hard on the concrete. He was not the same guy that he was before. It basically knocked him back to third grade. When he was in rehab, he was tripping over himself. He was rambling. You know, he would just start talking, you know, gibberish. He just wasn't present. He wasn't himself. And that is one thing, the biggest thing, aside from my life, that this helmet has saved is my brain and my personality. When it comes to brain injuries, it can vary as far as what your symptoms are. It's all about where your brain was injured. So there's people who have lost complete memory. They actually have to write things down throughout the day to keep track of what they've done. If they went to the bathroom, you know, if they just anything throughout the day, they're actually writing it down. Their speech can be impaired. All these things are preventable from wearing a helmet. There's a lot of people who were married and they ended up getting divorced as a result of their brain injury because, you know, they might be very hard to take care of. Or the other thing is, since their personality is so much different, there's women that have said, you know, this isn't the same man that I married. That is one thing that I feel like I still have. I still have my personality. I'm still the same person. I can still joke. I can still do everything, you know, mentally that I could do before my accident. Obviously, there are some restrictions from a wheelchair, but I've overcome quite a bit of stuff. I even, believe it or not, I even modified my motorcycle to ride post-injury. It had little legs that folded down and a electric shifter. So what I would do is I'd push a button, the legs would fold up out of the way, and I would ride again. So that was one thing right after my injury that really kind of kept my mind out of the dark side. Obviously, I had a couple times where I thought about committing suicide. I didn't think that I could live my life from a wheelchair, or at least not have a quality, you know, life. I've found that that's complete bullshit. I have a great life. You know, like I said, I've got a great wife. I still hang out with friends. I still go on vacation. I still go swimming. I still do pretty much everything that I used to do. I just do it a little bit differently. So that's really all I wanted to share with you. I know people that ride motorcycles are extremely hard-headed. I was one of them. My accident, I thought, you know, if I ever got in an accident that I would break a leg or I would break my arm. I never imagined that I would smash into a tree and be paralyzed. But then again, if I hadn't been wearing the helmet, I would be dead. That would have been end of story for me. And I don't have the brain injury, like I said. So I can still do everything that I did before, just a little bit differently. Another thing I've still been able to do is watch my niece and nephew grow up, just to see them from a little baby and, you know, the toddlers they are right now. To watch a child grow is just an amazing thing. I think, you know, if I was already a father, there's no way in hell I'd be on a motorcycle myself. But think about that. I mean, if you got killed, who's going to take care of your kids? And do you really want them growing up without a father, or growing up with a father with a brain injury who can't take care of them? I think that is the biggest reason. If you are going to choose to get on a bike, you need to get a helmet and you need to wear it. Don't have it strapped to the side of the bike as you're going down the highway. That's not going to help because anything can happen. That's one thing I've figured out. I took a advanced writing course 2 weeks before my injury. I mean, I was a safe rider. I did everything I thought I should. I wore the full gear and stuff happens. I mean, it's just how it works, especially these days with everybody on their cell phones constantly. Accidents are everywhere around the corner. And if you're on a motorcycle, you don't have a cage around you. You're not in a car. You don't have an airbag. You're pretty much exposed to anything and everything on the road. So that's really all I wanted to share with you. If you have any questions, write in the comments below, and I'll talk to you soon. Thanks a lot.
I thought he did one of the best jobs giving a testimony of why it's so important to have a helmet on, and to see his courage to press on in his life and not to let that one incident define who he is. It is a serious thing when you have a life-changing incident like this. So like you said at the end, do everything that you can to be safe, whether you're in the car or if you're on a motorcycle. So we talked about ramping. So here's the definition that I was talking about, how the back of your head should be placed squarely so it's not going over the back end. Now, I want you to write this down in your notes because I'm going to show you one last video. It's a little bit longer. It's about 12, 13 minutes. There are three types of collision that they talk about in this video. And this is probably the most scientific video that I'm going to show you, but it really defines what is happening inside of a car. So there are actually things that are happening to you in your body that I want you to take a look at and why you just can't underestimate the safety devices that we have. So we're going to take a look at that right now.
Why is it that some spectacular race car crashes produce only minor injuries? How can three collisions occur in this one crash between a car and a wall? The answers are determined by the laws of nature and can best be explained when physics meets biology. Through injury biomechanics, the study of the effects of forces on the human body, we've learned much about what happens in high-speed race car crashes, and doctors and engineers have used this information to build safer race cars and tracks. In a similar way, the study of injury biomechanics and crash testing has helped us learn what happens to the human body in passenger car crashes, and what works and doesn't work to reduce injuries and deaths in real-world crashes.
Hi, I'm Griff Jones. I'm a science teacher, and I'm here at the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety's Vehicle Research Center to explore the basic science behind injuries and vehicle crashes. So let's go behind the scenes and take a closer look at what happens to the human body in a crash. What is the first scientific discipline that comes to mind when you think of car crashes? It's probably physics, right? Because Newton's laws of motion govern what happens to a vehicle in a crash. But if we want to understand how crashes cause injuries to people, we need to look at what occurs when physical forces are applied to organs, tissues, and cells. This happens when physics meets biology in a field called injury biomechanics. The Institute's Vehicle Research Center is a world-class facility for vehicle research and testing. A reporter described the crash hall with its three runways as a cross between a Hollywood soundstage and a NASA cleanroom. Vehicles are propelled down the runways at precise speeds using a system of nitrogen-powered hydraulic motors and cables. The lighting array provides up to 750,000 watts of non-glare illumination for the 500 frames per second high-speed cameras. The research tests they're conducting here today focuses on how injuries occur in real-world crashes. This experimental crash replicates one in which a car hit a tree. In an attempt to understand injury patterns found in the occupants of the actual crash, researchers have disconnected the airbags.
Looking at the driver's chest, we can see the chest deflection reached about 50 millimeters of compression. The chest acceleration is 70 to 80 G. Resultant acceleration range. High likelihood of skull fracture.
Very bad.
Yeah, very bad.
Figuring out what just happened in this test crash is the job of the research engineers here. Using sophisticated tools like instrumented crash test dummies, instrumentation in the car, and slow motion film, they can analyze every detail and construct a precise picture of exactly what the vehicle and the occupants went through. When research engineers use terms like the chest deflection reached about 50 millimeters, how does that relate to what a human occupant would experience? If chest acceleration is 70 to 80 G's, which means that a force equivalent to 70 to 80 times the weight of the dummy's chest is pressing on it, is that survivable? How do these guys know the answers? The search for the limits of human tolerance to forces began decades ago. Today's race car and passenger car drivers benefit from biomechanics studies that were conducted during the 1940s, 50s, and 60s in the field of aviation, investigating how to protect pilots and astronauts from the strenuous forces of ejections and high-speed travel. Colonel John Stapp, a medical doctor and biophysicist in the United States Air Force, used himself as the test subject in his investigations of human tolerance to high G environments.
From the outside, watch the breakneck stop.
In one of his many tests, Dr. Stapp reached a speed of 632 miles per hour before one of the most powerful braking systems of all time stopped him in 1.4 seconds, subjecting him to more than 40 times the pull of gravity, or 40 G's. His research helped establish the limits of human tolerance to high G environments and saved many lives through development and improvement of protective systems for ejection seats. Realizing the Air Force lost nearly as many men to car crashes as they did to plane crashes, Dr. Stapp began a car crash program using the rocket sled for seatbelt experiments. Human volunteers working with his biophysics research team endured as many as 28 G's during safety belt tests. This early research laid the foundation for the complex crash analysis that is conducted here today. These dummies are a perfect example of combining science, technology, engineering, and mathematics to produce new tools that extend scientific understanding. They are the modern-day version of Dr. Stapp's volunteers. There's not just one dummy for VRC testing, nor even one type. There's a whole family of dummies for crash testing.
This is our crash test dummy family, ranging from a six-month-old all the way up to a 95th percentile male.
95th percentile of what?
That means that it is larger than 95% of the male population in the U.S.
Wow, so this is a big guy.
Yes, if he could stand, he would be about 6 foot two, about 223 pounds, pretty big. The female, if she could stand, about 5 foot tall, 107 pounds.
How about the smaller dummies?
They're called crabbies.
Crabbies? Are they moody?
They're not moody, but it stands for child restraint airbag interaction.
And so when we're doing the frontal crash test, it's 50th percentile?
Yes.
Okay. Side impact is the small female.
Side impact dummy is a very complicated dummy. It has the most instrumentation. They have sensors from the head to the toe. The accelerometers give us the acceleration of the mass. The load cell measures force. Mm-hmm. And then we have the potentiometers that measure the displacement the ribs actually move.
So dummies are very sophisticated. They provide data from many different body regions. But how do we connect this to people? What is the link between all these crash test data and the injuries that people experience in real-world crashes?
The dummy is measuring different things. It's measuring acceleration, force, and in some cases, distortion of the body parts. Those measurements can be compared against similar measurements made in experiments on biological tissues, using either animal models or cadaver models to get an idea of how much stress can this body part take before it breaks. So in order to understand whether or not a person would be injured, you need to know how strong the bones are, how strong the tissues are, and what conditions will cause them to break.
So the crash test dummies try to get a clearer picture of what's really happening to the people. Is that where the term biofidelity comes from?
It's exactly where the term biofidelity comes from. What biofidelity means is the characteristic of the dummy that represents how close to actually being a human being it is. So the higher the biofidelity, the more like a human being it is in representing how it moves, what types of stresses it measures in the crash test, and then the true-to-lifeness of those measurements to the prediction of injury in a real person.
This is how research engineers can tell us with precision what a human occupant would have experienced in a test crash. Dr. Stapp's experiments, plus years of research with real biological tissues from cadavers and animals, have produced a set of reference values against which we can compare the stresses and strains the dummies experience. So, we can measure these in a test crash and can figure out if they would cause injury to a human occupant. But what do these stresses and strains actually do to people to cause injury? Let's start with some basic anatomy. Your body contains over 100 trillion cells and is structurally organized into four levels: cells, tissues, organs, and organ systems. Tissue is a group of similar cells working together to perform a common function. Organs are made up of two or more types of tissue working together to perform a specific function. And each organ is part of at least one organ system that performs major activities or processes. Your body contains four fluid-filled spaces called body cavities that house and protect your major internal organs. Within the body cavities, your organs are suspended in fluid that supports their weight and prevents them from being deformed by normal movements. Your organs are also protected by your bones and muscles. For example, your heart and lungs are protected by your rib cage and sternum inside the thoracic cavity. Your brain is encased within your cranial cavity and is protected by your skull. Now, with this as background, remember the question from the beginning of this film. How is it possible to have three collisions in a single crash? Remember, the laws of physics hold true everywhere. On a highway, on a racetrack, and even inside your body. If a race car is going 200 miles per hour, so is the driver's body and every organ inside it. Let's answer the question. The first collision is between the car and the wall. The second is between the driver and the car's interior. And the third is between the driver's internal organs and the inside walls of his or her body cavities. To help us understand more about what happens to organs in the third collision, let's meet Dr. Stephen Olvey, a neurocritical care physician and director of the Neuroscience Intensive Care Unit at the University of Miami's Jackson Memorial Hospital.
Basically, during a crash, you have three collisions. You have the initial crash of the vehicle. Then you have the occupant hitting something inside the car and coming to a sudden stop. This results in impacts inside the body. For example, the lungs can hit the inside of the rib cage. The heart can hit the breastbone or inside of the rib cage, resulting in either pulmonary contusion or myocardial contusion. This is what causes ruptured spleens, lacerated livers, because you have part of the organ well anchored and the other part is free to move about. And this causes a shearing force to take place in the organ, resulting in hemorrhage or tearing of the tissue. The brain is enclosed in a rigid case, the skull, and it's cushioned and surrounded by the cerebral spinal fluid. The cerebral spinal fluid is actually a different density than the brain itself, so in the event of an impact to the skull, the brain begins to move, the cerebral spinal fluid begins to move, but it moves at a different rate than the brain. So it'll actually displace the brain in the opposite direction of the initial impact to the brain.
This simple experiment helps illustrate the phenomenon. This represents your skull. There's water inside representing your cerebral spinal fluid, and the red gel is your brain. The gel floats because it's less dense than water, just like your brain is less dense than your cerebral spinal fluid. What do you think will happen to the brain during impact? Will it move forward, backward, or stay in the same spot? Let's see. The initial movement of the brain is toward the back of the skull. The more dense cerebral spinal fluid moves toward the side of the skull impact, displacing the brain in the opposite direction. If the impact is strong enough, the brain will initially impact the back wall of the skull, then rebound and hit the front of the skull. This type of injury is called the coup contre coup, which is a French term meaning blow against blow. The order of events inside the skull is still debated in the medical community. Whether the more dense fluid displaces the brain in the opposite direction first, or whether the brain moves in the direction of the initial impact first and then is displaced by a wave of spinal fluid is not yet fully understood. By the way, this simple experiment was designed by a high school student for her science fair project. It was later published in a medical journal and has contributed to the debate. Crash injuries occur when stress develops in tissue. Another way this happens is when one part of the tissue or organ is firmly attached to the torso and another part is free to move. For example, with the heart and its blood vessels, the ascending aorta and its arch are mobile, while the descending aorta is fixed. Here's a demonstration of how a sudden stop, like a third collision, can cause an acceleration injury to the aorta. The aortic arch is represented by the unsupported gel. The gel inside the tube represents the descending aorta, which is fixed to the body. Try to predict what will happen during the collision. The unsupported section of gel continues forward and tears away from the supported gel. During an actual collision, the fixed descending aorta will decelerate along with the body, while the arch and ascending aorta's momentum keep them moving forward. This difference in acceleration or deceleration causes a tear where the fixed and mobile parts meet. Even the inertia of a blood-filled heart can cause stress and strain on the aortic arch. We've been talking about stress and strain on tissues and organs, and we've seen how a crash applies some of these forces. But what is stress and strain in this context?
Okay, that was very technical. The reason why I wanted to show this to you is that most people don't realize what is happening inside the vehicle. And while I was looking at the video being played, because I can check to see how many people are still looking, tuned in, and the number dips down, that I am going to keep track of those that are answering questions during our class, that when we start driving, you will get top priority on drive times. So if I notice that people have tuned out and they're not paying attention during class, and I see you've got a number of missed opportunities to answer questions, you are going to go down to the bottom of the driving list. And right now the driving list is very, very long. So to go to the very bottom is not something that you want to do. Now, I'm probably preaching to the choir, which means I'm looking up here. There are only 16 people that are still with us. So you're the only ones that are going to know how this is going to actually run. I'm kind of disappointed that this online is not being fulfilled the way that I had hoped to with this particular class. Last class was a little bit better than this one. Well, let's talk about the video for a second. And I'm not going to talk about the crashes, because if people are texting me in now, I'm not going to accept the text answers now. In the first crash, you have a lot of control over that. Okay, that has a lot to do with your preparation as a driver of using your safety equipment. Now, the second crash with you and hitting the vehicle inside has to do with your seatbelt. And then the last one is just luck, how your organs are reacting to that last collision. But you've got to understand the slowing down of the body is so important. So that's why the body moves forward, as we said, 1.3 with the hips, a little bit more with the chest, and then the airbags are going to take over. So that's really important that you understand how that works. So hopefully tonight that provided you a good overview of seatbelts, airbags, and helmets. So let's talk about homework. I'm going to put the first one up here. I'm going to put this on Facebook. This is going to be tying into what we did last night. This has to do with your car manual. I want you this weekend with your parents or a brother or sister. I don't care who you do it with. You can do it with it or by yourself. But I want you to download this from the Facebook page that we have. And I want you to look in the owner's manual and understand what type of fuel to put in your vehicle. How big is your gas tank? How big is your tire? How do I get a tire if I have a flat tire? What size do I put on? And then in your owner's manual, you may not be able to find fuses. Sometimes you can, so try your best. Same thing with bulb numbers, like what I'm looking for. What is the part number for your headlight? What is the bulb number for your dome light or for your parking lights, your hazard lights? So when you go into an auto body store, you're going to have to either give them the burnt out bulb, or you can just take the part number like you're going to find and explain, this is the bulb that I need, and then you should be able to replace it. The last thing that I want you to do, and this is more of a bigger project, so it's not due on Monday, but it will be due on Tuesday, is that since we covered seatbelts, airbags, and helmets, and I'll put this on Facebook, Because it's not the project. If you take a look at your syllabus, it talks about a project at the end of today's class. What this is I want you to do a poster convincing somebody to wear their seatbelt. All right, so you're making a poster. It doesn't have to, it could be right on the back of a blank piece of paper, but I want you to include two facts. So stuff that we talked about tonight, things that you find on the internet, tell me two things about seatbelts or helmets or airbags. Two facts, only about one of those topics. You're not doing all three. Make sure it's colorful. Make sure you have some type of graphic, and that's the seatbelt. Okay, you can do that. Or you can just take your phone, write out a script about what would you record for a radio announcement that would be heard over the radio. We call that a public service announcement. Has to be 30 minutes in length, and you would send it to me over your phone. Send me the link to it. So you would be talking about some of the facts like I'm doing with you, trying to convince somebody why it's important to use a seatbelt. And if you want to get extra credit, if you're too bored at home, I mean, I know we have this, you know, stay in place order going on, but if you want to get creative, you can do a video. And this is one of my favorite student videos. So if you do a video, still want two facts. He didn't do the two facts, but I thought he did a super job with his video. So I'll show you a student video.
All right, Violet, time for school.
Can we listen to some music?
Yeah, what song?
You know what.
It's the one and only Deco Double G.
Snoop Dogg.
Da, 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 da. You know I'm hopping with the D-R-E.
Yeah. You know the West Coast is back for all you suckers. Suckers. Up. Put something in there.
Raise it up.
Put it in
there.
Yeah. Suck, no.
Top dog, by them all. Yeah, I'm burning it up. DPGC, you should be talking.
So I thought he did a fantastic job with the videography, the music, the script. So you have three choices, the poster, the radio ad, or the video. But the video is going to get you some extra credit on the final. So that's it for tonight. Remember, you do have reading to do for next week. So it looks like we're going to talk about licensing, titling, and registration. So chapter 2 in responsible driving with the questions. And read section 2 and 4 in the state manual. So that's what we're going to cover on Monday. Have a great weekend, and we'll see you on Monday. Good night. Remember to text that you're signing out so I know that you are here at the end. So I'm looking at my clock. It's 9:19. You got 2 minutes to check out.